thank you for still being here, so to speak. I'm going to speak about the Moesgaard style. My name is, as I said, Jette Lindå, curator of historical archaeology at Moesgaard Museum and head curator of our exhibition on the Middle Ages that opened in October 2017. Here you see our museum. I call it a new museum. The museum is still reasonably fairly new. It opened in 2014. The building cost 75 million euros. The architects are Henning Larsen Architects, which is next to big, probably the most important architect company in Denmark, also the ones who have built the opera in Copenhagen. We opened our exhibitions one by one through a few years. So at the moment, and since the Middle Ages were the last one of the permanent exhibitions, we now have six permanent exhibitions open. One Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age, Viking Age, and then ethnography, and then the Middle Ages, of course. Our building or our team, our museum is special because we have our own in-house exhibition group. The only thing that we buy out-house are certain movie productions. Everything else is done by a team that has more or less been constant since the opening in 2014, 10 people all in all, architects, interaction designers, who does our virtual reality. We have scenographers, we have ordinary architects and sound and movie engineers and so on, which is a great advantage as since every power struggle between science and display is put to rest by our head of exhibition, who is an archaeologist. So that makes dealing with the balance between ambience and authenticity, which is basically what I'm going to talk about, that makes those struggles much easier. As you see them, the building here, it is kind of, well, it's kind of the hill that opens. It's one of the national narratives of Denmark, that it was a hill, and then it opened sometimes in the 16th century, and some kind of elves came out. So this is basically that narrative. So our building is a hill that opens, and then you enter, and the front room with our restaurant, our ticket offices, and so on, is at the ground floor. Our administration is at the top, and you actually go down into the ground to see our exhibitions. Yes. And our exhibition hall lies in an old cultural landscape. This is the Manor Moesgaard, which is head of, or the administration of Moesgaard Museum as a whole lies there. We are an archaeological, ethnographical museum. And then the manorial landscape is still intact. We own all this land here, which basically means that people come to our museum that lies around 12 kilometers outside the center of Aarhus, and Aarhus is the second biggest city in Denmark. When we are able to attract visitors here, some come to see our exhibitions, of course. Some come to enjoy a cup of coffee. Some come to walk their family and children in our landscape. And while they're here, they might go look at our exhibitions. So that adds to the attractions of this, in a geographical sense, rather remote place. Yes. As a museum, we have a motto. Humans at the heart of history. We have had that for decades. It means that we, so to speak, put our visitors face to face with the past. We give our visitors, our guests, as we call them, a sensoric experience. We have our starting point in an unrecognizable face that you can relate to. And our exhibitions, as you can see here, are generally dark and colorful. When we go from the light and airy entrance hall into the exhibition, you go through this staircase of evolution. At the top is Lucy, the first humanoid, 400,000 years old. Then come a Neanderthaler, Cro-Magnon here, someone here, and here is the oldest skeleton that of woman that has been found in Denmark with real reconstructed faces, all of them has. So kind of when our guests enter the exhibition down the staircase, they really go face to face with their ancestors. We usually jokingly call this the Willy Parade because of all of the naked persons there. We were afraid, or someone worried, that we were going to get reactions, but no one has ever said anything. Absolutely no offense from anyone, which is quite fun. But anyway, walking through the staircase, our visitors get embedded in the past. Oh. And some of them enjoy it rather much, as you can see. When we now go down here to the medieval exhibition, the starting point, or the mental starting point for this exhibition when we started, was this map, a Salter map, so-called, made around 1260 for Henry III in Winchester near London. It's a map that unites the sacred, mythological, and historical events, and does so within the heliocentric worldview that was specific for the Middle Ages. In this map, layers of time and spatiality are embedded, Jerusalem in the center as usual, Garden of Eden over here, then North Europe over here, so it embeds several layers of events and time. Our position is, so to speak, to place our visitors in the heart of the past and then and let them look out instead of placing them as strangers looking in. That viewpoint is shared by all our exhibitions. It also meant, as I've said, that human life experience had to be the center, and every story, every object, was to take the starting point in a single human or groups of humans. So this is not an exhibition about technology or institutions, but it's an exhibition about what effects technologies and institutions had on human life. And here we have the map of the medieval exhibition and the introductory hall here. And from there you walk to the countryside, to the city, then we listen to the Baltic Crusade. We go up into the castle. We have a section of death, and then you actually die and go into the castle. So this is immaterial before birth, and this is the time. Yes. Our exhibitions are built up by five layers with different balance of ambience and authenticity. The ambience of this room gives our visitors a sensoric insight in the Middle Ages. Through sound and colors, we aim to embed the audience within a reconstructed medieval soundscape and visual culture. We balance absolute authenticity in our display of objects. There's not one single reproduction in any of our exhibitions. We balance that with the highest degree of accuracy in our reinterpretation of the medieval soundscape and landscape. And here, when you stand there, you actually listen to the voice of God telling you about the medieval worldview. No one has taken offense about that, I don't know. When we go further inside to the countryside, you can again maybe better see the balance between ambience and authenticity. And it's clear that the ambience is overwhelming, and it is in every one of our exhibitions. The wheel is our common symbol. It can be the wheel of fortune, it can be the wheel of a plow or a mill. So we use that to put on our displays or our movies. When we did that, this part, when we created this part, then head of exhibition, was Pauline, was unhappy with it. She said there's nothing there, and this is about the countryside. There were no objects. Well, she said there was no objects, and she said it was boring. I said, dear Pauline, that's kind of the point in this. But we had a bit of a tiff about that. If I'm to talk about the next layer, that is our texts. They are highly dramatized, or what is written on the wall, so to speak. There's not much, and what there is are highly dramatized. We talk directly to our visitors. The voices changes. This is also written from the perspective of an all-compassing trinity of God. All the text has been written by our scientists, and then gone, many of them gone through me, because not everyone is able to write in that specific style. Our third layers are what I call talking heads. We don't have normal posters explaining explaining technologies or specific topics. We have researchers on touch screens. Researchers being filmed live, 2 to 4 minutes, no script, no cut. That is challenging too. Mm-hmm. And they talk about their given subjects, and it's the curators who have given them these subjects that they talk about. This is the archaeologist or researchers taking on the classic role of the shaman or guide, if you want, who leads or guides our visitors into the past. And it is quite efficient, as long as we remember to put that little thing on bottom that shows how many minutes. If it's not there, everyone will leave immediately. If it says that this takes 2 minutes, they're going to stay. Here you have the talking heads in real life. This is our section on manorial life, where this screen is on, where you can just press some questions, and then a researcher comes up and explains about that. And here you see the visually overwhelming setup of our exhibition cases that is meant to embed the visitors in the visual culture of the day. The fourth layer is our VR, virtual reality. We have 3D goggles in other part of the museum, but not in the medieval exhibitions. It's incredibly expensive to make that. Our VR is here done as dramatations. This is a movie that represents an authentic court case from the 15th century Aarhus, which has been dramatized to give information on the juridical system as well as social conditions in the city. And the visitors take part as jurors in the trial. We use this to tell about social conditions in the city. This particular scene you're playing here is about a poor thief who got hanged at the square in Aarhus. We also have a section on immigrants. Our exhibition consists of authentic objects, as you see, not one single reproduction in any of our exhibitions, that are embedded in a highly sensorial setting. The lighting is dramatic, the visual and auditive stimuli embeds our visitor in a virtual reality of their own. Creating such a balance of ambience and authenticity was challenging. And here I'm going to, in the last few minutes, speak about a few of those challenges. The first one is really the balance between ambience and authenticity. Creating ambience in the afterlife, and here we are in the section of the afterlife, I think this is going through purgatory. Creating ambience in that was incredibly easy. This is a typical form. I would love to use it as a reception room or party room. So it was very, very easy. We all have these images of hell and purgatory in our heads. But creating authenticity in this section was harder. We tried to dissolve that by using original images by contemporary artists, Bernocke, Hieronymus Bosch, that is put up on the walls. Bernocke was an easy choice, given that Bernocke, painter, sculptor from Lübeck from the late 15th century, that was an easy choice given that his works adorned the visitors in Aarhus. However, Hieronymus Bosch was difficult to embed from a curatorial viewpoint, but very, very easy to embed from our scenographer. from the viewpoint of our ethnographers. Because Hieronymus Bosch's style plays into present imagination and perceptions of hell, but the Spanish-Dutch court culture he represents has fewer links to Denmark. So here, the, so to speak, imagination or ambience was stronger than authenticity.
And it was one of the battles I lost.
Sorry.
Yes. Yeah, I know.
No, she's okay. No. We saw it late.
As you see here, and that is getting two clashing sounds and sights. As you see here, the exhibition room is definitely cramped. That is in accordance with the medieval worldview and medieval life, but it has the unfortunate effect that some of the sound effects get muddled. However, the soundscape greatly adds to the ambience. So here, ambience one, and I have to say that the adjustment. There's, as always, almost no time for adjusting sound before we open, and everybody said we're going to do that later. That hasn't happened yet. That's just luck. And then there's the third challenge, offense. I've already talked about the Willy Parade and the use of the voice of God, and no one has taken offense. But in this section on the church, we discuss the medieval perceptions of materiality as a medium of transformation, that is miracles, the materiality changes all the time in the Middle Ages, that's one of the characteristics. So we have recreated a miracle that washes away the sins you can commit other places in the city. So something actually happens when you touch the relic, you have to kneel, and then the scent of roses go up and all that, and something happens. We thought that someone was going to take offense on that, but nothing has happened. No one has said anything. The only offense someone has ever taken was a firm LGBT supporter who took offense because our translator has translated the mortal sin of superbia with pride. And she didn't like that use of the word pride, and has very other connotations today. She asked if it was on purpose, and I can say, honestly, it was total incident. Nobody has given it a thought before that. Challenge four is what I call guardians of the galaxy. Unbelievably, perhaps a lot of thought and money went into this figure and background, and this is the work of my co-creator, who was very good, actually. But somehow, I don't think that thought and money really paid off. Intense care was taken into the layout of every detail in the armor, the building, the horses, and so on. But the message of this scene totally gets lost. So up to me, it looks like a cartoon, and to me it doesn't pay off. So we could have done that, maybe thought a little bit more about what it is we really wanted to say, or what is the emotional content of this scene. Then in the last 1 minute, I'm going to talk about challenge five, that is reinvention. Every one of our permanent exhibition, as well as our special exhibition, costs between 1 and 2 million euros, probably more like 2 million than one. The museum itself attracts 300,000 visitors a year, and we need to reinvent our exhibition constantly to be able to make them visit again. All the six permanent exhibitions are open now, and now we are in a phase where we open one big special exhibition every year and several smaller ones. And this is our current exhibition on Genghis Khan and Mongolia. Our in-house exhibition team has started working in museum productions other places in Denmark and Europe, so that's also a possibility. And that is the complete team here, and they develop, of course, the most on time according to what other places want. I'll only say now that you, of course, always very welcome to visit. But if you do come to visit, then please put up a few days, because all our visitors and all the researchers who come to us say that our exhibitions are intensely overwhelming on an emotional level. just with their fans. Thank you.